we're gonna fix the red graph, because the red graph, we're seeing too much of it.
Yeah, because you know what they can see right at the
calm down. So the red graph.
Why did you put him at the front of the classroom?
He was at the front of the class last time.
He was sure I focusing hard and
not. The red graph. Should we see the red graph here?
Yeah.
Because it's greater than
here.
X is greater than 0.
X is 3, so yeah, it's greater than 0. Here X is 2, that's greater than 0. All of these places, we should be seeing the red graph, but we shouldn't see it here, because X is, right, in this direction, X is less than 0, so we shouldn't see it over here. Right, so we shouldn't see it there, shouldn't see it there. I accidentally erased some of the blue. We shouldn't see any of the red graph there. Let's fix that. But as soon as X is 0, and anything bigger than 0, that's where we want to see the red graph. Okay? But we don't want to see any other parts of the red graph. So, like I said, we graphed it directly. We said here is where the graph should be, and we're not going to draw it anywhere else. But this time we drew both graphs, and then we erased the parts that we weren't supposed to have. Questions about that one? Does that make a little more sense?
Yeah.
Why is it going up?
This one?
Bigger than 0.
X should be going down.
Why should it be going down?
Oh, I see it. If X is greater. Oh, I see it.
Dude, you came in with him.
I know. I'm just rethinking.
You still want to get through quick rewinds.
All of, like, try and say things, whoever you are, so that the thing you're saying helps the class, not makes the class laugh. It doesn't really matter if the class laughs or chuckles, or thinks what you said is funny, entertaining, she's helpful, helps along dramatically. Tyler?
Should it be able to go down?
Which one?
The red.
The red should be going down?
Could it be?
Well, like, I guess it could if we were dealing with a different function, but this function has a y-intercept of 0 and a slope of 4. So we call that slope 4.
Oh, so the x has to be greater than 0.
Right. So the red one, we should be seeing right from here on. Because x is greater than 0 that way. When x is greater than 0, that's when we're going to see that red graph.
Oh, it's actually a shame up there. My bad. My bad.
When x is less than 0, we should see a blue graph. And when x is equal to 0, we should see the red graph, which we know we graphed right because we have the filled in symbol. Okay. Letter 6.
Less than?
So number 6 is similar. It just has 3 pieces in this piecewise function, as opposed to just 2 pieces. Now this function looks like this. It's going to be the function negative x plus 2. Sometimes. Other times it's going to be the function y equals 5. Other times it's going to be the function y equals 3x. It's going to be this function y equals negative x plus 2 if x is less than or equal to negative 2. It's going to be y equals 5 if x is greater than negative 2 less than 1. Then we're going to graph the function y equals 3x if x is greater than or equal to 1. So we'll have a graph paper.
Can we
we'll mark that off in the graph paper. What's that?
Can I move that over here? I'll do the second one.
All right, so you can see that the cutoffs for x are at negative 2, 1, 1. One of the functions is going to be showing over here. Another one's going to be the graph that we see
over
between
there.
These two. And the last one's going to be
over there.
Here.
Wait. All right, I'll do number first one.
Okay, tell us how to graph the first one.
Alright, so we're gonna go plus two.
What does that mean?
Two on the y-axis.
Okay, so we're gonna go up two on the y-axis because that is?
The y-intercept.
Okay, so we got a y-intercept of two, but hold on.
What?
Should I make a point there?
I don't think circle.
Should we make an open circle? Or should we not see this graph at all?
Not that
right
at all.
We shouldn't see it at all, but we do want to make graphing
simpler.
Can't we just erase it off?
Yeah, so we'll just, or we'll make it just a couple of points to help us find the slope and we'll do it from there. But we do want to recognize that this part of the graph, we don't want to have it. We don't want it to be showing. So maybe we'll just follow the slope up and give us a couple of points, you know, in that direction.
Okay.
So the slope of this guy, the y-intercept is 2, the slope is what?
Negative 1.
So we're going to make a back to the left move and up to the up one move here. Okay, back to the left and up one. Alright. Now, should I see the graph there?
Right here?
It says when x is less than or equal to
negative 2. Yeah, you can play it right there.
So we could start like really drawing those points starting there. You go back one and up one from there, another point, and there we go. We got two points we could use to draw a line. Just go ahead and get rid of those.
I think it's hard to draw one.
So could you just sit in the very back there, please?
Yeah.
Thanks. Okay. Let's jump to the other side, to where x is greater than or equal to 1.
So if we have this right here, which we're going to be starting at 0, right? Because
we would have a y-intercept of 0, yeah?
And then go up 3 and over 1.
That's right, we got a slope of 3.
Right there.
And should it put a solid or an open circle?
An open circle solid. Right there at the 0.
Should I even put any kind of... Because the graph eventually is going to ultimately not be there, right? This purple one is only when x is greater than or equal to 1. Well, that is from here... over, right, this direction.
Oh, so you have to go over 3.
Don't want to see any of this purple graph here.
So you'll have to go over 3, over 1, and up 3 again.
So, yeah, there we go. We'll give ourselves 2 points that are actually where they should appear. Let me put that one back.
And then you'll put...
Well, let's finish drawing this graph. That graph goes off that way. We don't see it at all, except for at 1 and greater than 1, to the right of 1.
So if a y for 5, you just put a dot for 5 on the y right there.
And so this is the function y equals 5. Kind of a funny function. There's no x in this function, right?
So the x is
the slope is 0. 0x plus 5, right? So it does have, as Skyler said, a y-intercept of 5. Right? Slope of 0 would mean
that you would go over the other way. Yeah, right there. And then you'll make an open circle there.
Open circle here. Why open circle here?
Because if it's greater than negative 2.
Is
so
negative 1 greater than negative 2?
No.
No.
Actually, yeah.
Yeah, it is further to the right? So actually, that point should be included in the graph. Once we get to negative 2, though, the point being that, like, all the points that make up this graph are just right across from each other, because all of these points, what's the y value of any of these points?
I think the homework said that it was open circle.
Please answer my question. What is the y value of any point on this horizontal line? Thank you. It is 5. Okay. But as this graph gets close to where x is 1, should we see the graph or should we not see the graph? Should we graph the graph or no?
No, you put an open circle.
So should I put an open circle there? Because when x is 1, we should be on this graph. Likewise, over here at negative 2, open circle.
Good. Got that one, huh?
Yes, we certainly got it done. Now it asks us, so it asks us to do this for 2 as well, to describe the domain and the range. The domain is all the inputs, all the values you can plug in for x. The range is all the outputs, all the values you can get out of this function for y. So let's think about the domain. As you look at this graph, wherever the graph exists is where the function exists, where the function works. Okay. So as I think about the domain, I'm thinking about what values can I plug into this function? What's allowed? Let's go to a random x value. This x value. Is this a valid 5? Is that a valid input?
Yeah.
Let's look at the graph and see if we can figure it out.
No, because there's no line going over it.
Should there be graph somewhere up here, maybe?
Yeah.
If the graph keeps going,
yeah.
What about an input of 10? Is that valid?
Yeah, because it's
infinite. Way up there, higher than I can reach. But there is a graph up there somewhere. What about 1?
Yep.
Yeah, there's a point there. What about
0? Yes.
Yeah, we use this point. Not this point, because that's not really a point. It's just an open, empty space, open circle. Okay. So 0, yeah, I can input 0. Can I input negative 1?
No.
Look at that.
Well, I thought you were talking about that.
This is it. This is the function. Okay.
Yeah.
So if I go to negative 1, is there some part of the graph there? Negative 1? Yes, there's.
Either way, all of them are going to work.
Either way, whether we go to the right, we're going to find a graph over there. Go to the left, we're going to find a graph there. Stay at 0, we're going to find a graph there. So is there any value of x that you couldn't put into this function?
No.
No. So all real numbers. You could write all real numbers, or any number is fine, or x can be anything, or however you want to say x can be any number. But that symbol right there means all real numbers. Could be more accurate than that. Okay, the range, that's all the outputs. What kinds of things do we get out of this function? Let's look this way to see, like, can I get this value out of the function? Can I get this value out of the function? Get this value out of the function. Right? So, yeah, like for say negative 4, just real quick for reference, look, the graph, there it is. There is some x value that I can plug in where the output is 4. The output can be 4. The output can be 10. Can the output be negative 5?
Yeah.
It could be, because there is a graph there. There is a point right there, and the output of that point is negative 5. -4, -3, what about -2?
No.
Can we get -2 out of this function?
No, because it's an open circle.
Almost, right? If that was a solid circle, then yeah, it would be at -2, but that point is not included. What about -2.1?
Yes.
Yeah, just below that. What about -2.00000001?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sure. Even just slightly below -2, good, but -2? No, you're never going to get that out of this function. There's this big open gap here where if I go left and right there, I will never ever find any part of this graph. So what things can y be then? Y could be what?
Everything besides 2.
Everything besides 2. What about 2? Okay, everything besides -2. How about -1?
Yeah. No. It could be -1 because.
Well, that's what it can't be, which is a valid way to tell me what it can be. But let's say, like, what can it be? What can y be? Basically, I have to break it up into
-3?
Two things. It can be -3. Can it be -2.5?
Yeah.
-2.01?
Yep.
Yeah.
As long as it's.
Not -2.
Okay. Well, there's numbers that are up here that are not -2 and numbers down here that are not -2. Which ones do we want?
All of them.
Up top.
You want the ones up top? You want the...
Oh, I don't know mine.
So So we want these guys down here, right? All these y values are cool. Y is less than negative 2. Can y be greater than negative 2? Can, but not all values greater than negative 2, right?
Right.
There's some that don't work. These guys in here don't work, right? So let's not include those. Let's kind of jump that gap and start here, right? Go up from there. So what? Which y values are those? Y could be less than negative 2 or
greater than 2.
Greater than
or
0.
Equals 0. You can tell the domain and range by looking at the graph. This way, left and right, there is no x value that's off limits. Go to any x value you want. You might need to go up or you might need to go down, but you're going to find graph there. Right? But when you look this way, I look at the domain, or sorry, the range, you go up here, there's going to be graph up here, there's going to be graph way down here, but there's not graph right in here. There are no, this graph doesn't have any outputs, this function doesn't have any outputs between negative 2 and all the way up to almost 0. Okay? Doesn't have any inputs in there. So y can only be values that are less than negative 2, or y can be values that are greater than 0, or it can actually be 0 as well. It includes 0. Okay? So those are the values that y can be. That's the domain. Let's take a look at the domain and range. So that was the range. What's the domain and range for this function? So what do we say the domain is? Everything about that? Is it all real numbers or is it?
No.
Else?
It can't be all real numbers because you can't do 4.
No.
I mean bottom.
What's that? You can't do 4?
Yeah, you can't do 4, 3, 2, 1. Just in between those, you can't do
4, 3, 2, or 1. Remember, we're talking about the domain here, the input, the x value.
Oh.
So you can do
can
all.
Can this function handle an input of 4?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't handle a
0
or a
1.
Can this function handle a 0 input? Here's the input of 0. Look at this graph right there.
Oh, yeah.
Can it handle a negative 2?
Yeah.
A 1?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
all the
numbers. Between negative 2 and 1.
So all of them work.
Yeah, all the x
all
values.
All the numbers.
Okay, all the x values are fine. All real numbers. But the range, what about the range, the y values?
You can use all of them.
All of them? Anybody name a y value that this function doesn't have?
3.
3? 1, 2, 3. Does this point have a y value of 3?
Oh, yeah.
It does.
Oh, negatives.
Okay, the negatives are... Is this function ever going to get a negative out of it?
No.
Is this function going to have a negative 1?
No.
No graph here anywhere. And, you know, obviously I keep going to the negatives. No graph's going to be there. So negative numbers are off limits. Clint, what do you think you got?
Should be all numbers, real numbers, 3 and greater.
3 and greater. So y is greater than or equal to 3. Even though this looks kind of funny in here, the thing is, every value greater than 3 is a valid output. We can get that value out of this function. We can get 3 out of it. We can get 4 out of it. You can get 5 out of it a lot of different times, right? And there's like an infinite number of inputs that give us 5 as an output. Okay, still a function, though. Okay, can I get out of this 6? Yeah, there and there. 7 there and there. So on and so on. So every output, 3 and greater, can come out of this function.
Wait, I have a question. So the green one, what's up there? This one or this one? What does that mean? Because it's only a 5.
So it means... This function y equals 5.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's just talk about that as an aside real quick. Y equals 5 as a function. The thing about a graph is it's a bunch of points. And all those points, we can make this equation true. The funny thing about this equation is there's no x in it. Right? Which kind of implies.
It just sideways.
Yeah, it just doesn't even, x doesn't even matter at all. No matter what the x is. If x is a million, y needs to be 5. If x is 0, y needs to be 5. If x is negative 30, y needs to be 5. Always 5. So every point that has a y of 5 is the graph that we want. So this has a y of 5, and this. All the points where y is 5 is just this flat line at 5.
Okay.
And So we see a little piece of that right there between negative 2 and 1. We see a little piece of this guy here when x is less than negative 2, and a little piece of this purple one when x is greater than 1.
I see.
All right, the last one was
11.
What's that?
Oh, if you go back.
If you go back.
Then why doesn't it contain the positive graph?
This one?
Yeah.
Because of this. It tells you the only place to graph that flat line is where x is greater than negative 2 and less than 1.
Oh.
And that is only from here to there.
I see.
So you just kind of splice that piece, take it out, we put it right there.
Okay.
So number 11 is about renting a wood chipper for 4 days, so we don't have to worry about anything greater than 4 days. Should we talk about days that are negative?
You can't have negative days.
Negative days is kind of a silly thing, so we're not going to talk about that. Okay. So, well, do you think it talks, makes more sense to talk about the function or about the graph first?
The function.
Okay. Well, we're going to start like kind of from beginning to end of the domain here. And we're going to kind of break it up where things start to change. On the first day of renting this equipment, it costs how much?
$100.
$100.
Good memory. So it costs $100 to start with. What x values are we talking about there? Or what, like what days?
Zero to one.
0 to 1 days. Okay. 0 up to and including 1 full day. Would you agree it includes one, or should one be part of the next one?
One should be part of both of them.
It includes
both
one.
Of them?
Mm-hmm.
It includes one. Because if it's one,
it should
day,
only be included in either this one or the next one, but not both. Because if it includes both, like if the person who's in charge of taking your money for the equipment, they're like, okay, one day costs $100 and one day costs $150.
Oh, I thought you meant 1 day
to
2 days. That's
okay,
what
I got
this.
Well, for this one, it should be from 1 to 2, but should it be like that? That should be like, once you get past 1 day, now it's starting to be more expensive, up into and including right up 2 full days. How much does it cost from a little bit more than 1 day all the way up to 2 full days?
$150
total, yeah. That's how much it's going to be. Right, $50 for that extra day, but we got to add the rest of that. So $150. Okay, how much is it going to cost the day after that?
$200.
That's going to be from after the second day is over up until
the
we've got exactly 3 days, you know, like until the very moment they close the doors on that third day. And then it's going to go up to $250 anytime between the
third and fourth
the end of the third day up until your complete fourth day.
Wait, what is that 0 and that 1 for?
What is that for? Someone have an explanation for what's that 0 and 1 for?
The 0 means that's when you got it.
Yeah.
And then the first day is the 1, because that goes all the way up to the first day.
Right, so you guys are all familiar with renting things, right? And renting equipment is no different if you rent a wood chipper.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go there and you say, I want to rent a wood chipper, and you do all the paperwork, they give you the wood chipper, you give them $100, you have it for 3 seconds, and you give it back, how much does it cost you?
$100.
$100, kind of a dumb thing for you to do, but that's how much it would cost to rent it for 3 seconds. Okay?
Only which
to rent it for 23 hours and 59 minutes would cost how much?
$200.
$100.
Still $100. 23 hours, right?
Oh, I thought you said
23 hours and 59 minutes. Would be still
$100.
3 seconds or 24 hours and 59 minutes. It's all within that first day, between the 0th day and the first day. It's all $100. Yeah.
But if you think like in real life, if you rented one though, then it was like 24 hours and 10 minutes, it turns you another $50.
I mean, it all kind of depends on
the people are nice.
Who owns the business, or maybe you're not dealing with the owner, you're just dealing with an employee who's trying to do a good job and charges you what it says he should charge you.
I know a lot of people
that give me
money.
That's great.
That Subway?
Yeah, thanks, Grace.
I never gave you anything for free.
Gave me a free cookie.
No, I didn't.
Oh, yeah,
did.
She gave me a free cookie.
She stole money from your wallet.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so now we show the graph of all that. So from, let's make each of these Y tick marks, let's make it 25 each.
Okay.
Because we're dealing with such large quantities.
Let's do 50.
No, 50's too big.
50's not too big.
We're doing 25.
Yeah, that's 50.
So that's 25, 50, 75, 100.
$100.
Okay. Well, they're not going to start charging us until we've had it for a positive amount of time, right? So they're not going to charge us for 0 days, seconds. But just after that, they're charging us $100 to the end of the first day. Then after we've gotten officially into the second day, like once they close their doors that day, that's technically the time they're going to start charging you $50 more. So it's going to be $50 more than 100, so 150, right? Those tick marks are 25 each. So all this day, it's just still going to cost you $150 up into the very end of that second day. Then it jumps up to $200. And stays $200 for that entire day until the very end of that day. Jumps up to $250.
So like the open circle's like kind of like the start to finish?
Kind of, yeah, because if we were actually right here at exactly 3 days, it would still only cost you $200. As soon as you go one hair past 3 days, now you're up into the 250.
In real life, do you think it'd be like that? Like, if you got, say, you rented something at, like, noon, and the next day you come back and you bring it back at 10? Do you think they'd cost you 150?
Well, if you rent it at noon and come back at 10, that's less than a day.
Yeah.
Yeah, but
it's like,
you got it yesterday.
Oh, I think they're measuring in like 24-hour periods, not like day.
So you
would
have to come back. If you didn't return it by 12 o'clock the next day, then it would be.
So they're going by military time?
No,
they're just going by 24-hour blocks.
Quantities.
One day is 24 hours. So 24 hours from the time that you pick it up. Of course, in real life, there's all this flexibleness. Sometimes it's not like return it 24 hours from now, it's just turn it in tomorrow by closing. Because let's say I rent it at
an excavator
4 o'clock and they close at 5. So I rent it at 4 o'clock on Monday and I bring it back at 4:30 on Tuesday.
Like Redbox? Would that work?
Yeah, it's kind of like Redbox, you know, you can rent it. But so if I were to come back at 4:30 the next day, why would they charge me extra money? I mean, technically, I guess they could, but what are they hoping to rent it somebody in that last half an hour? Probably not. So it's just going to sit there anyway. So it depends. Like, real life, obviously, is different from this function. Real life usually is different from a function that we use to model it. It's not perfect, but it's close. That's the main idea behind those kinds of rental. But yeah, Redbox is a good example too. Like after one day, it's pretty cut and dry. 9 p.m. to 9 p.m., 9 p.m. to 9 p.m., 9 p.m. to 9 p.m., right? But the day of that first day is a little bit sketchy.
Yeah.
I could rent it at 6, return it by 8:59 the next day. I've had it more than 24 hours. But that's in keeping with the policy. All right. Any questions about that? You already asked a bunch of good questions.
So would you like graph that as in like make a line out of all those points?
No, because like renting from this place, you'll never be charged, say, $225.
Mm-hmm.
It will never cost you $225 because that's not how they work. It's full chunks of $50.
Okay.
Right? And so there is no in between. There should be no points between those two.
Mm-hmm.
If we were less advanced, right, like we were just a few days ago and no, we knew more linear, then we would probably draw a line with a slope of 50, right, over 1 and up 50,
mm-hmm.
one day, $50. But the truth of it is when we rent it, we don't really rent it anywhere in between those days. It's either 3 days or 4 days.
Okay.
That's it. Clint?
Oh, sorry, I'm scratching.
All right, well, let's take out a piece of paper, each of us.